Welcome back, everyone. In this video lecture, I will derive for you the equation of motion of the single pendulum. I already prepared a figure of the single pendulum where a point mass m is attached to a massless bar of length l. I have also included the coordinate frame xy and the angle theta, and the positive direction of theta is as indicated in the figure. Now let's recall first the kinematics. So from the kinematics, we concluded that this system has 1 degree of freedom, that total set of generalized coordinates consists of x, y, and theta, and that the independent one is theta. That's why we added theta to begin with. And the dependent ones are x and y. All right. Now, from the kinematics, we also established the relation between xy and theta. And for the remainder of the derivation, I'm going to need these relations on the acceleration level. So I will just write them down again. It's not that they are so important that you should learn them by heart. And I can imagine if you don't know these by heart or you don't remember them, look them up in the previous lectures, or just assume, just be happy with how they look. So we had terms that contained these Eulerian acceleration, theta double dot times L, and we had the centripetal acceleration, theta dot squared times L, and they are like this, okay? So this was derived before. Now, I summarize this kinematic analysis because, in my opinion, the kinematics is the most important thing to start when deriving the equation of motion. Some people argue that when you make when you try to derive equations of motion, you start by making a free body diagram. That's also the approach that I see in many textbooks. In my experience, doing kinematics first leads to a more structured approach, and you will quickly discover why. Because at this point, I'm going to make a free body diagram. So let me make a free body diagram of this mass m and include forces. So we have gravity, m times g, and we have the tension in the bar that I will call T, like this. So this is the free body diagram. Okay, now I turn my attention to the force balances. Let me write them here. Sum of the forces in the x direction, to the right positive, is equal to mass times x double dot, according to Newton's second law. Well, what are the forces in the x direction? In fact, we only have the component of T, so that is T times the sine in the negative direction, so minus T times the sine of theta. And in the y direction, sum of the forces in the y direction, positive up, we have mass times y double dot, and that is equal to T times cosine theta in the positive y direction, minus m times g. Okay, so these are the force balances that follow from the free body diagram. Now I would like to ask your attention for the number of unknowns in these balances. We see that all the three coordinates, x, y, and theta, or their time derivatives, are appearing. And moreover, we have this unknown force T. So in these two force balances, there are four unknowns. This means that these force balances by themselves are not sufficient equations to solve for all unknowns. This is generally the case. If you have an arbitrary system and you make all the free body diagrams and you count the number of unknowns, there are more unknowns than equations. And the additional equations always follow from the kinematics. So maybe you can see that these equations, if we would substitute them in the balances, are exactly the equations that allow us to eliminate for x and y. And then the balances reduce to two equations where we have t and theta and its time derivatives as unknowns. Okay, so in general, the force balances themselves are not sufficient. We always need the kinematics. So then my recommendation would be start with the kinematics, because that also already learns you a lot about how the system is going to move, what effects play a role. Start with that, because then we have these kinematic relations set up already. We don't have to look for them in this stage. So that's nice. However, in manipulating the equations further, I will not substitute these kinematic relations yet. I will first get rid of the unknown constraint force T, or sometimes you also have unknown reactions. First get rid of that one. How to do that? Well, I can take the force balance in the x direction, rewrite it such that I have T is something else, and then I substitute that in the y balance, but it can be done much smarter. So what I will do is I will multiply this equation by the cosine of theta and this one by the sine of theta. And the reason is that this term with this unknown force T will then in the force balance in x direction become minus T cosine sine, and in the y direction we have plus T cosine sine. So if I were to add these two equations, okay, the term with T cancels. Let's do that first. So we get M times x double dot times the cosine plus M times y double dot times the sine. And then if I add the two right hand sides, the term with T cancels. So we just have minus mg times the sine. Okay, so this would be my recommendation. If you start manipulating equations, first get rid of the unknown constraint forces or reaction forces. In general, this will reduce the amount of writing to a minimum. Then, this would be a good time to substitute the kinematic relations to get rid of x double dot and y double dot. Before we do any writing, let's just look at these relations. So we need to multiply x double dot by a cosine. So this will result in a term with theta double dot cosine squared and theta dot squared cosine sine, which has a minus sign. And then the y double dot term needs to be multiplied with a sine. Well, then focus on the term with theta dot squared. Okay, that will be theta dot squared cosine sine with a plus sign. So upon substitution, these terms cancel. So that is really nice. So the result will be m l theta double dot times cosine squared. And we have m l theta double dot sine squared is equal to minus mg sine of theta, because the theta dot square term cancels. And now we see that we have ml theta double dot, once with a cosine squared and once with a sine squared. Well, since cosine squared plus sine squared is equal to 1, this reduces even further to ml theta double dot itself. And now I will take the term with mg sine to the left plus m g sine of theta is equal to 0. Now, this is already one form of the equation of motion. It can be done even more compact by dividing by m. So then we have that l times theta double dot plus g times the sine of theta is equal to 0. Okay, and this is the equation of motion of our pendulum in its most compact form, equation of motion. So that's nice. Let's reflect on the procedure. So first, do the kinematics. Conclude, we have one degree of freedom. Theta is the independent one. Because we see in the end, the equation of motion is one equation for the independent coordinate theta. Okay. When doing the balances, first get rid of the reaction and then substitute kinematic relations. That is the least amount of work. Okay. Now, then if we look at this equation of motion, we observe that it's a second order ODE like before. Coefficients are constants, G and L are constants. It's homogeneous in this case because there's a zero on the right hand side. However, it is non-linear due to the presence of the sine of theta. So it's not that theta itself is there, the sine of theta is there. So that is something we need to take into consideration later. Okay. Now, we have the equation of motion now, but I will show you one alternative way of getting there that is also based on the kinematics. So let's recall the kinematic diagram of this pendulum, kinematic diagram that we established when we did the kinematics. So this is the point mass, and we have, oh, let me do it like this. In this direction, we have theta double dot times L, and in this direction, we had theta dot squared times L. Okay, let me compare this with the free body diagram. Let's see if I get them in one screen. Yes. Okay, so I draw the direction slightly differently. I apologize for that. Maybe, yeah, let me do the free body diagram again. Here, free body diagram. Body diagram. Then I will use similar angles. I think this is going to be convenient. M. And then I should draw T in this direction. And M times G in this direction. Okay. Now, the kinematic diagram that we got from the kinematic analysis looks like this. So, if we compare these two diagrams, what we can observe is that this theta dot squared L is in the same direction as T. Okay. Rather than taking force balances in the x and y directions, I could choose now to make a force balance in this direction. Okay. If I do that, I also need the acceleration, the absolute acceleration in that direction. And if I do this, the nice thing is that T does not enter the equations to begin with. Okay, let me write that down. So sum of the forces in this tangential direction, it's sometimes called, let me denote it like this. So in this direction as positive, is equal to the mass times the acceleration in this direction. Look at the kinematic diagram, the acceleration in that direction, that is L times theta double dot. Okay, what are the forces in that direction? Well, T is perpendicular to this direction, it has no component. So only we have in the negative direction a component of the gravity, which is minus mg times the sine of theta. Okay, so if I rewrite this, we have ml theta double dot plus mg sine of theta is equal to zero, dividing by ml theta double dot plus g times the sine of theta is equal to zero, which is the equation of motion of the pendulum. So here you see, if you compare this method with the previous one, you can see that indeed the resulting equations of motion are the same. So this is correct. And we got there much faster by picking a smart direction for the force balance based on the similarities between the kinematic diagram and the free body diagram. Now, what can I say about this method in general? It really depends on the specific problem whether or not we can pick such a smart direction. And it does require some insight. Okay, so maybe for this problem, it's relatively straightforward. In general, it's more complicated. So I do advise you to be very, very careful there. Okay, what always works is do the force balances in X and Y direction like we did here. Okay, that will always work. The worst thing that can happen is that you do, too much work, more work than strictly necessary. But you will end up with the correct equation of motion. Okay, so if you choose to do force balances in a different direction, be very, very careful, because this is prone to making some mistakes in your judgment. Okay, but if you know how to do it, it can save you a lot of work. So I think that's nice to see. All right, this concludes the lectures on point masses. In the next video lecture, we will turn our attention to rigid bodies for the first time. See you there.